Hi everyone. I hope you guys can hear me well.
Yes.
Thank you so much for having me today here. I'd like to thank Naugaon College and World Researchers Association, as well as Northeastern Institute of Ayurveda and Homeopathy for organizing this a conference, which brings actually many interdisciplinary fields of chemistry, biology, into one. And I'm pretty excited to talk about my research and my outlook about plant-based remedies against viral diseases. I would like to share my screen now with you. Can everyone see it?
Yes.
Okay. All
Yes,
right.
it's coming.
Okay, so I always like to start my presentation with this particular slide. This one actually is a quote from Louis Pasteur, who is also the father of microbiology. And this one talks about the small nature of microorganisms and how the impact of those small, like infinitely small organisms, can be infinitely large. So the best example would be COVID-19. We all know how small the virus is, but the impact that it has throughout the world has, I think, it has never seen before. So it's infinitely large. Anyway, so okay. So my name is Dr. Devjyoti Bhuiyan. As you already know, I work as a postdoctoral researcher at Nickam Health Research Institute, Western Sydney University. And as a part of my research, I'd like to do so many community engagement. So I like to interact with people on social media. And these are my social media handles. If you like to follow me, feel free to follow me on these platforms. Today, I'll be mostly talking about antiviral compounds from natural sources, mostly from plants, and what are the current trends and what are the future directions in antiviral research. Okay, so why we are talking about virus? I think this is probably the most relevant times. As we know about COVID-19, we all do. We all are affected somehow, either physically or mentally. And if you see this particular slide, it actually shows the global pandemic and epidemic diseases as per World Health Organization. And you'd see there are around 20 different diseases that they have listed recently in 2020. And out of them, 16 are actually viruses. So there is definitely an urgent need in terms of antiviral drug development, in terms of vaccine development. So you'd see these 16 are actually the pandemic and epidemic diseases that are caused by viruses. And this particular diagram actually shows that the whole world is actually responsible. We cannot just say that we cannot just pinpoint at one country and say that they are responsible for a pandemic or epidemic. The whole world is responsible, and it's all of our responsibility to control it. Okay, so these are some of the medically important viruses. You'd see that viruses can be actually classified into DNA and RNA viruses based on their nucleic acid. So DNA viruses, as the name suggests, they have DNA as their nucleic acid, as the genomic material, and the RNA viruses have RNA in them. So the coronavirus that we are currently experiencing, COVID-19, and the SARS that we had, I think, in somewhere in 2000s, and MERS, which is Middle Eastern-born respiratory virus, and that all these viruses actually belong to coronaviruses, which actually belong to RNA viruses. These are type of RNA viruses, and same goes for influenza and HIV viruses. So I would, in this presentation, I would actually briefly talk about different sorts of viruses and different antiviral compounds that have been in the pipeline without going too much into specifics. Okay, so let's see the structure of SARS-CoV-2, which is this COVID-19 virus. So you'd see this, the coronavirus, the name itself is suggests. Corona means crown. So the virus actually looks like a crown. if you see the basic structure of the virus, it has actually different nucleocapsid proteins. And then they have spike proteins, envelope proteins, and membrane proteins, and also RNA in the core. So these all these proteins and the RNA play a very play key role in terms of what they do in terms of infecting a host. So you'd see that these have different roles and different functions, and how they actually, this is a paper actually recently published in Nature. It shows the role of different proteins and envelope and RNA in pathology of SARS-CoV-2. Okay, so this is the mechanism. So when we talk about antiviral drugs, the antiviral drugs actually work on different aspects. So where a antiviral drug can actually block the entry of the virus. So a virus to be able to infect the host, it has to actually attach itself to the host cell. So our cells, human cells, actually express different types of receptors, which where the virus actually can come and bind, and then they enter the host, and then they start uncoating themselves and start replicating and synthesizing new viral particles. So when you talk about antiviral drug, these are the mechanisms that are important while designing an antiviral drug. So you can see that these are some common examples of the standard antiviral drugs that we have, and how they work. So most of the virus actually, they prevent the entry of the virus. These antiviral drugs, for example, diconazole, which is used for herpes simplex virus. And then there are other virus, other agents like interferon alpha, which is which helps in blocking the penetration of the virus. And then there are actually inhibitors that inhibit the reverse transcriptase enzyme, which is important for viruses like HIV. So they actually inhibit that enzyme, and the virus cannot undergo the process of reverse transcription. And same goes for proteins or antiviral drugs that can block the protease inhibitors that help in actually assembling the viral particles inside the host cell. So these are different mechanisms that actually the standard antiviral drugs that we have, the commercial or the medically available drugs that we have currently, they work on these ways. But there is one problem. So the funny thing with viruses is that it actually is considered something between living and dead. So that's why it always very quite difficult to design an antiviral drug, because the metabolism itself is different with viruses. And as a consequence, what happens is that these standard antiviral drugs that we currently have, they have a lot of side effects. These are some of some of the side effects that you would find with most antiviral drugs. And Tamiflu, which is an antiviral drug used for influenza, and that one is also associated with several side effects like fatigue, vomiting, nosebleeds, stomachache, headache, and nausea. And they can also damage organs like kidney, liver, and pancreas, and heart. So that's why I think that's why we need natural alternatives, or maybe plant extracts or compounds that can be isolated from plants, which have antiviral effects. Okay, so this is an example of. This list is not exhaustive, okay? So there are many more plants that have been explored against different sorts of viruses, but I'm only putting these out there because these are some of the common ones. One of the most common one from India especially is neem, which has been tested against dengue virus. And then you'll get olive leaves, like the leaf of olive trees. And then tea tree, for example, aloe vera, garlic, ginger, and even eggplant, which is botanically known as Solanum melongena. So this, they have been actually explored against different sorts of viruses. So you'll see this particular list and the common plants. Most of the plants actually are also from China. Many Chinese actually traditional medicinal plants have been explored against SARS-CoV. So you'll see a lot of studies recently. They have actually used different plants that are common in traditional Chinese medicine. They have used those plants to actually treat SARS-CoV-2 in China. And there are actually a few studies based on that, what you call those findings. So this one is one of the most important classes of phytochemicals that actually have a lot of potential. When I talk about antiviral therapy in terms of SARS-CoV-2, for example, or HIV, which the research is still in its like preliminary stages. So there's so much that we have to do, and there's like immense scope basically. But I want to concentrate on this particular group of compounds. These are actually polyphenols. So these are phenolic compounds. So they have multiple phenol rings in them, and they can be actually classified into phenolic acids, flavonoids, terpenes, and lignins, and then they can be subclassified into different sections. So anthocyanidins, for example, are found in grapes and blueberries and strawberries. They can be used against viral infections. So if you see this particular picture actually shows most of the food and food products that we regularly use, including green tea, apple, grapes, then pomegranate, chocolates, for example. These have polyphenols in them, and they can be quite beneficial in terms of giving a good health to your immune system and good so to support the immune system. I don't want to say that polyphenols will boost your immune system, that you would see like on social media. Basically, there are so many people actually claiming that this particular herb will boost your immune system. That actually is not true. It can support your immune system to work properly, but it cannot boost your system. So polyphenols also have the same role to play. They can support your immune system, but they don't actually necessarily boost your system. Okay, so these are some of the examples of phenolic compounds and how they have been actually used against viruses. So you'll see these are common phenolic compounds like catechins, which are actually found in green tea and black tea. Then chlorogenic acid, epicatechin, bakelin. I don't want to read from this slide. You'll be able to see that. And so these compounds like curcumin, for example, which is actually isolated from haldi, which is turmeric. So that has been shown quite potent antiviral activity in the current literature. And most of these polyphenols, they have been actually used against herpes simplex virus 1 and 2, then HIV, and then influenza, which is H1N1 and H6N1 and hepatitis C. So in terms of most of these studies, if you read, they are actually in vitro studies. So that means they have been done only using some cell-based assay. So you'll see some in vivo studies that use animals like mice and rats, but they are very rare. And in terms of their molecular mechanism by action. So as Professor Garg was telling in earlier that, and also Professor Goswami, he also mentioned that it's, the thing is with herbal medicine that sometimes we know that they work. We talk about like Ayurvedic medicine, for example, and home remedies even. So we know that they work, but scientifically, we don't know how they work. So that's why studying the molecular mechanism of action is extremely important to generate a scientific finding. So I generally prefer to see studies or do studies that actually look into molecular mechanism of action rather than just saying that, oh, okay, this a particular compound will kill virus on this particular cell line, but we are interested in how actually they work. So that's what my area of expertise is all about. My area of expertise actually, it's all about microbiology and anti-cancer research. So I want to see how herbal medicine or phenolic compounds or other groups of compounds can be used and how they work at a molecular level against cancer and bacteria, fungus, and virus. So the studies that I have seen in the literature currently, list these molecular mechanism of actions. These are basically like, as we have seen before in with regards to standard antiviral drugs, the herbal extracts or the compounds actually work in a similar way. So you would see that most of the compounds will block the entry of the virus, so the attachment and the entry. And then there are so many protease inhibitors as well that actually blocks the assembly of virus once it's inside the host. Then there some compounds actually inactivate the viral particles. Some will actually work on the replication of the virus. So for example, there are inhibitors that can inhibit the reverse transcriptase. So there are actually phenolic compounds that can work on that level, and they can stop the replication of the viral genome, whether that is DNA or RNA, they can stop that. And also there are agents that can incorporate themselves in the viral DNA, and then they stop the replication of the viral DNA. In terms of indirect mechanisms, like there are actually two mechanisms. When you talk about antiviral research, there are two mechanisms. One, the compound is actually going and targeting the virus itself on different, as I mentioned, on different aspects of the viral replication and infection. And the second one is that you are controlling the inflammatory response that our body is producing in response to the virus. So with SARS-CoV-2, with COVID-19, the virus itself is not dangerous. So if you look at the genome of the virus, it almost seems like the virus is very confused in a way. So it has some characteristics of a bad virus, and then it has some characteristics of a virus that cannot do anything. So the genome of the SARS-CoV-2 is quite contradictory. So that actually somehow tells us that it cannot be man-made. So if someone designed the virus for as a bioweapon, they would actually design it in a way that the virus will just kill everyone, and then it will have all the bad characteristics. But in case of SARS-CoV-2, the characteristics are actually quite confusing, you know. So that's why so what happens with SARS-CoV-2 mostly, it's because of the cytokine storm that our body produces. So in response to the virus, that actually makes things worse. So there are actually ways that these phenolic compounds, for example, can actually support that, they can actually regulate that cytokine storm. So what is cytokine storm? Basically, it's nothing but an overexpression of your body's inflammatory, anti-inflammatory response. So it's normal that in day-to-day life, we actually are encountered with so many different bacteria and funguses and microbes in general and foreign particles. So our body immune system is important to fight against those agents. And same goes for SARS-CoV-2. But in case of SARS-CoV-2, that body's immune response, the anti-inflammatory response is actually so much high, like it's so high that it actually produces a storm in the body of anti-inflammation. So it's called cytokine storm. And that makes all these pathologies related to SARS-CoV-2 very hard to handle. So you can actually use phenolic compounds to control that cytokine storm, and you can actually use it as an alternative approach to treat SARS-CoV-2. And that's exactly what China is doing in terms of their traditional medicine. They're using all the anti-inflammatory herbs and herbal formulations to treat SARS-CoV-2 patients. Okay, so this is one of the most common approach in antiviral drug development for COVID-19. So you'd see that as we don't have, like all of us might, all the researchers that are currently working with herbal medicine will not have access to having the virus itself, the SARS-CoV-2. So what happens, we already actually look into the antiviral activity that we already know of some of the natural products. And then we look into the molecular structure and the proteases that are present in COVID-19. And then we try to see if those natural compounds with known structures can actually interact with the COVID-19 protease using a computational model, which is also called in silico assessment. And then we do docking analysis, and then you actually predict, basically. So you predict whether this particular natural product will work on COVID-19 or not. But this approach is not necessarily foolproof, but that's the only way, because we don't have the access to the virus. Or maybe, you know, for that virus to be able to work with SARS-CoV-2, you should have a biosafety level 3 facility, which might not be available everywhere. So that's why this is one of the most common approaches that people are taking in terms of antiviral drug development for COVID-19. But this approach is flawed in a way that most of the times, although in silico assessments can give you some idea of whether a drug will work or not, until and unless you actually run in vitro studies and then in vivo study and then clinical studies on the natural products as antiviral agents against COVID-19, you won't be able to tell. So most studies that are currently available in the literature, they talk about docking analysis and in silico assessment, which I feel that they are very important. They are quite important, but they're not the end game, you know. Okay, so this is another approach for bioactive compounds and how they can be beneficial for COVID-19. So you see most of these natural metabolites. So these are actually flavanols or flavanones, and then triterpenes and curcumin derivatives. So as I said before, flavanol and flavanol, these are all phenolic compounds. And curcumin is actually a compound that is present in turmeric. And they have actually, curcumin is very tricky in a way that curcumin has kind of a bad and a good reputation. It is actually considered as one of the most promiscuous compounds because it doesn't have affinity towards one particular receptor or one particular target. It actually goes and binds to different targets. So that sometimes actually causes problem, because in modern medicine, what we want is something that actually goes very specific in terms of its target selectivity. So curcumin sometimes have that issue. So what we do is that we actually modify the curcumin. We can use, for example, in anti-cancer research, I can tell that they use platinum-based analogs. So they mix curcumin and platinum together, because they know that curcumin works for cancer and it's not very specific sometimes in terms of the target. Whereas platinum also works against cancer, so they can combine those two and they can get some derivatives. And same is happening with COVID research as well. They're actually trying to derive several analogs from curcumin and test them against SARS-CoV-2. In terms of these compounds, in terms of that target, you see that most of the papers have actually reported like targeting ACE2, which is angiotensin converting enzyme 2, and also like there's a protein, spike protein, which is TMPRSS2, and these are the two main targets. And also this is in terms of the host cell. So these two targets are present in the cell membrane of our, like the cells that we have or animals have. These two are the main targets. And also there's another target on the virus itself. It's called 3-chymotrypsin-like protease, and that actually helps with the attachment of the virus with the host cell. And these compounds, curcumin derivatives and phenolic compounds and quinones and triterpenes, they actually target these three different targets, two on the cell membrane of the host and one on the SARS-CoV-2. So this is one of these are all based on very new research, and this particular paper was actually published in Royal Society of Chemistry in 2020, based on the studies that have been done so far against bioactive compounds for COVID research. Okay, I think I was telling you about the cytokine storm before. This is a visual representation of how cytokine storm works. So you'd see that there are actually three different stages. You'd see patients that actually don't show any kind of symptoms, even though they have COVID. And then there are people who show moderate symptoms, then severe symptoms. So this actually happens because of the cytokine storm, as I was mentioning. And cytokine storm is actually composed of three main cytokines. In case of COVID-19, it's TNF-alpha, which is tumor necrosis factor alpha, then interleukin-6 and interleukin-10. So these three are the key cytokine storm. There are other cytokines as well in the cytokine storm. And in terms of when the COVID-19 actually pathology is severe, so that means the patient has high level of cytokine storm. So you can use anti-inflammatory compounds. So phenolic compounds can actually, they have been shown to produce a lot of anti-inflammatory properties as well in several cell lines and animal models. So you can use anti-inflammatory compounds to actually control the severity of COVID-19 in terms of controlling the cytokine storm. So this is an alternate approach that I think we should explore because of having a virus and having a compound that has antiviral properties, and the resources and the money and the manpower that you need to do those research is actually quite significant. So we can actually look into alternate approaches like anti-inflammatory compounds to treat viral infections, including COVID-19. Okay, and this is another way that actually herbal medicine and also diet for that matter can actually help you with fighting COVID-19. For example, if you see the picture here, you see that you can actually eat foods or herbs that are known to have what you call anti-inflammatory properties, for example, or that's something that actually help you help support your immune system, something that has that have antimicrobial properties. So you can include those food groups in your diet and also the herbs. And then you can also use herbal medicine to like make masks. So you can actually coat the mask with compounds, the herbal compounds and extracts that you know are actually antiviral in nature. So that will actually prevent the virus. That will be an added, added measure, I would say. And then you can use like air disinfectant, like essential oils from eucalyptus, which have shown a lot of antimicrobial properties, including like viruses, fungi, and bacteria. So you can use essential oils as air disinfectant, and also you can use these herbal medicines in making hand sanitizers, for example, or like making surface sanitizers instead of using alcohol, because we know that alcohol, using too much alcohol, sometimes can also trigger inflammatory response like dermatitis, for example. So we can actually look into herbal medicine and also bioactive compounds that are derived from herbal medicine and formulate these kind of products that are actually shown in this particular picture, and we can actually fight COVID like that. Although it's like these are alternative approaches that you can do in addition to standard antiviral drug development. Okay, so with phytochemicals as antiviral drugs, I think there are some caveats, there are some drawbacks, there are some limitations at the moment that we have to overcome. So first, I think would be the drug delivery system. So because bioavailability of herbal medicine or compounds that are present in herbal medicines is a big issue. So bioavailability in terms of can be improved using modern drug delivery system. So when we are talking about antiviral research, I think we should probably look into modern drug delivery systems as well to actually deliver the compound or the herbal medicine on the site or like to directly on the virus, if that makes sense. And also, like with conventional drugs, as I mentioned before, they have like efficacy issues and also toxicity issues. So with phytochemicals, we can overcome that, and we can actually use modern drug delivery systems or ways to improve the bioavailability of the drug to overcome the side effects of conventional antiviral drugs. Okay, so food for thought would be to these things. As I said before, the research is still in its infancy, and we need modern and optimal and green extraction methods. Because when you talk about herbal medicine and herbal compounds, there are actually so many what you call extraction methods that are currently available that we can use in terms of extracting those compounds from plants and efficiently. So, but you know, having said that, there are actually still a lot of research to be done. In my PhD research, I actually used microwave ultrasound to extract phenolic compounds from Australian eucalyptus and use them against different cancers and different microbial bacterial pathogens. So all I'm saying is that we need to define more modern techniques like that to efficiently take out or like extract all the chemicals from natural sources that are beneficial, and also that will actually reduce the environmental impact of the extraction technique, because all we know that, you know, these extraction techniques have so many side effects in terms of the solvent consumption and power consumption and things like that. So we need to define more green extraction techniques to isolate compounds from natural sources. And then the second one is more in vivo and clinical studies. So as I mentioned before, most of these studies are either, especially with COVID-19 research, most studies are molecular docking studies, which are in silico, or computational studies. They're not in vivo or clinical studies. So we need more in vivo and clinical studies to actually know whether something really works or not before making any claims. And then also we have to understand the molecular mechanisms of action as well. We need to know how they work, not just whether they work or not, but how they work. And then the next step would be to assess their bioavailability, whether I know that, for example, green tea will help me fight some viral infections, including influenza or common cold. But the green tea, the amount of green tea I'm drinking, for example, if I'm drinking 5 cups of green tea a day, I don't know whether that green tea, all the compounds, including catechins and epigallocatechins and all these bioactives that are present in green tea, are actually going in the bloodstream or not. Because in most of the times, they are actually excreting in the urine. So bioavailability is a big issue. So therefore, we need more research in terms of increasing the bioavailability of natural compounds or herbal medicine. How you increase the bioavailability, you can actually design different analogs, chemical analogs, or you can actually mix two different herbal medicines and see if they are actually synergistically working with each other in terms of its pharmacokinetics or bioavailability. And also modern drug delivery system, as I said before, we need to invest more in that. Like, for example, nanoparticle-based and liposome-based and erythrocyte-based systems. And also after that, we need to also assess the toxicity. I don't necessarily believe, although I work with herbal medicine, I work with bioactive compounds from plants and how they can be implemented in modern medicine, I don't necessarily believe that herbal medicines are necessarily safe. But this is a common misconception people have, that all herbal medicines are safe, because I grew up in India and I know that, you know, many people have this perception, all Ayurvedic medicines will be safer. No doubt they have less side effects, but they can be quite toxic. We actually recently wrote a review article based on the toxicity of herbal medicine and how different toxins that are found in herbal medicine can be quite dangerous, even lethal. To assess the toxicity in vivo models, in animal models, is another research direction that we have to take. And the final one, which is the synergy between standard drugs. So we all know, like people who work in drug discovery, we all know that discovering a drug is easier said than done, because you know it entails resources, time, money, you name it. So it takes years and years, like probably more than 10 years for like bench to bed, that whole approach, you know, from in vitro research to clinical research even. So that actually takes a lot of money and time. So we can actually use what we already have. For example, we have all these standard antiviral drugs, and we have all these natural compounds that are known to have antiviral properties. So we can actually combine them. So there's a big trend these days in terms of synergy research. So we call it synergy research. Our actually group from Western Sydney University at Nickham Health Research Institute, we specialize in synergy research. So our approach is combining two drugs or combining herbal medicine with Western medicine, using different mathematical prediction models and also in vitro and in vivo models. And you actually do combine them, and you increase the efficacy of standard antiviral drugs, and while you reduce the side effects, you know. So you are getting two advantages. You are increasing the efficacy by several folds, and you are reducing the side effects of common standard drug that we have. I think this is probably more sustainable in terms of research, because we cannot really just use one particular, like for example, we cannot really use just Western medicine or herbal medicine to treat, to approach viral diseases. I think the most logical approach or most practical and sustainable approach would be to combine them together. And finally, I feel that Northeast, I think many speakers have previously mentioned this before, because Northeast India is one of the biodiversity hotspots in the world. So in terms of flora and fauna, the biodiversity is like very rich, and there are so many different herbal plants or medicinal plants that are actually present in Northeast India. They can be explored, and I actually believe that, you know, these plants can actually serve as platforms for future antiviral drug discovery. With that, these are my collaborators with whom I actually do the antiviral and anti-cancer research. So you can see the people from Western Sydney University, Professor Chung Guang Lee, who is my current supervisor. Professor Chris Carlett from University of Newcastle. Then Costas, he's a good friend. He's from University College Dublin. And Amrita Basu from Masaryk University, Czech Republic. And also Professor Midla Soika Borua from Assam Agricultural University. We have actually recently collaborated with all these people, and we have published quite a lot of manuscripts as well. So yeah, these are my collaborators. With that, I would like to end my presentation, and I'm happy to take any questions if there is any.
Yeah, thank you so much, Dr. Bhuya, for your nice, very informative and excellent presentation. Young, talented researcher, very innovative work. Now, this presentation is open for discussion. I request respected participants, any queries, please.
I'm Dr. Porixi speaking.
Hello, Dr. Gogoi. How are you?
Very nice presentation, actually. After a very long time, I got a very nice presentation that you were presenting very nicely.
Thank you very much.
I really like that. I like all the slides that you are preparing and all. Presentations are very nice. So I really agree that you told me the last slide that though we are looking every plant, every trees as a medicinal value, have medicinal value, but we never thought of that toxicity of that toxicity effect.
Yep.
Suppose like if you have one positive class compound that is good for that one particular disease, but negative compound is very toxic for that. So we need to go for very extreme separation processes. So
it's not coming.
So that is, I really like that one. I have one question actually. That you told that during your PhD, you extract some phenolic compounds from eucalyptus. Actually, yeah. I'm really interested on that because since my group also working on that lignin from.
Sir, up.
Normal extraction process.
Dr. Gogoi. Dr. Gogoi. Your voice is not audible, please. Yeah.
I'm audible.
Still.
Yeah, hello. Hello.
I can hear you.
Yeah, please.
Okay, so like my first question is that like it is from the chemical from the lignin or it is like normal extraction process that you have did in your PhD work. Actually, I'm interested on that. And And second question is that the bioavailability of compounds. Have you told that key components like catechin or ethylcatechin or flavanol, centrosanes, all we know that these polyphenolic compounds, especially the curcumin, that is present in the all are these antioxidants, anti-inflammatory, antiviral activities. So like regarding the bioavailability, is there like special work is going on in your lab that you can combine with a special drug delivery system? Any work is going on?
Yes. Yep, definitely. So your first question was about whether I looked into lignin or not. Yeah, no, I think for my PhD research, it was mostly like a bioassay guided fractionation. So as you know that, you know, we only are looking into fractions that are active against pancreatic cancer. So with pancreatic cancer, the main problem is that the cell lines that we had used, they're so diverse in terms of their genetical heterogeneity. So we had to do like the whole bioassay guided approach, and we actually found out that I actually explored 9 different species of Australian eucalyptus, which was quite a big task to start a PhD with. And then we actually narrowed it down to 4 or 5, and finally we actually found one particular species called Eucalyptus microcaris, and that one had a fraction that was actually active against all these cells actually that we looked into, and that had very less toxicity. So in terms of the molecules itself, we only looked into the phenolic compounds and antioxidants, not lignin. But we did do a research, like currently as a when we're, like I'm working at Nick, Western Sydney University. We did look into a project that was actually commercially funded that looked into lignin from eucalyptus and how we can use that for anti-inflammation and antimicrobial properties, but not necessarily for my PhD. Yeah. And in terms of curcumin, yes, we are actually... as I said during the presentation, we are combining curcumin with platinum-based analogs to increase their bioavailability. Because with curcumin, you know that it's not dissolved in water or aqueous solution. That's one of the caveats that we have. You hear that curcumin is good for you, and also in terms of Indian practices, it's a good thing that we mix curcumin or turmeric with milk, which has fat in it, to make it more bioavailable. But even then, the bioavailability is quite poor. So that's why we actually do a lot of chain modification. I'm not a chemist, but one of my students, actually, she's doing her master's, and she is working with a different group as well. We are collaborating with a chemical synthesis group, and they are actually modifying the structure of curcumin, and they're adding platinum to make it more bioavailable and also to make it more potent for cancer.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Bhuiya, again. So any more queries from our respected participants?
Hello, sir.
Hello.
Yes. Hello, sir.
Hi.
Hello, sir. Myself, Manto Haloy.
Hello, Samantha.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Garlic chemical compounds. Yeah. Out of yeah. these compounds, which compounds generally offer the resistance against the viral disease, especially it's the COVID-19? Thanks, sir.
That's a very, very good question, but I'm not sure whether I can tell you the answer certainly, because as I said, research is still in its very early stages. But as far as I know, with garlic, I think there's a compound called allicin, which has been shown, yes. Which has been shown activity against different microbes and even different cancers as well. So I would say that allicin might have some sort of effect against COVID-19 as well, but it's very tricky to say. So I don't want to make a statement. And but yeah, you can actually look into that. But with herbal medicine, the main thing is that the synergy between the compounds is more important than an individual compound. So we are actually in herbal medicine, we're talking a lot about synergy these days, because we know, for example, if you are isolating a compound from a herb, in many studies, it has been reported that that compound is actually no longer as potent as it was in its extract. For example, in an extract, you will find a lot of compounds that can be active or inactive towards a particular disease or towards a particular microbe. But when you isolate them in isolation, they might not work properly. So that all the inactive compounds, even they play a key role in terms of supporting the active compounds. So I would say that if you can make a concoction of herbal medicine that has all the active ingredients as well as the inactive ingredients, that might work better than like a isolated compound itself. Does that answer your question?
Big challenge. Sir, yeah. Thanks, sir. That is the big challenge for standardization of the herbal drugs, sir.
Yes. Standardization is another big issue with herbal medicine because herbal medicine is entirely dependent on the source from where you're getting. The quality control is one of the big issues as well. Even in Australia, even though like in Australia, there are different agencies that do quality control, but even then it's quite difficult. And I can imagine that it might be more difficult in India as well. So yeah, I understand your point in terms of quality control.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much again. Actually, we have lots of queries to Dr. Bhuiya, but we have time constraint also. We are in a virtual platform.
Yes.
So if any queries, respected participants, please share your questions in the chat box. I, on behalf of organizing committee, request all respected participants. So thank you so much again, Dr. Deepjyoti Bhuiya, very talented researcher, innovative researcher. An excellent and nice presentation. Thank you so much
from
the Mount College family again. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.